Mini Chapter 87, The Platinum Raven in the House on Zeus Drive. This morning and afternoon are spent installing the newly incarnated Platinum Raven in her new home here in the House on Zeus Drive. She will be free to come and go, but Jaymi arranges that the property's housekeeper will call on her once a day to verify that all is well, treating her as Jaymi's tenant, which in a sense she is. Because he spent so many recent days on this very terrace, creating her components, he feels her mysterious platinum beauty is already immanent throughout this plot of land. Overlooking those Italian cypress fingers ranged across Laurel Canyon, this terrace, with its bird-of-paradise flowers, was already ashine with the platinum of her imminence. Now she is present in the flesh. Once Jaymi has kissed her goodbye, leaving her alone and self-sufficient at last, the Platinum Raven lies listless in the heavy heat, sprawled among the long grasses in a sickly sweet-scented corner of the garden, on a stretch of earth that so far down the steep slopes below her terrace she may never quite clamber this far down again. He has not, of course, really left her alone. In fact, he's slanting his attention back up and over the Mount Olympus hillsides towards her now, while he drives back down to the house on Electra Drive, only just noticing the fatigue she feels in her brand new body as a result of her convulsive meat space debut in the Blue Jay Way house. "Rest, my dear, rest," he murmurs aloud. Gazing sideways, the Platinum Raven becomes aware of something bulky behind a clump of tall grass nearby, but just beyond her reach, where wasps are hovering and dipping in the air. Wondering at it, she rolls herself a little closer and reaches out to part the clump, half fearing to reveal a corpse in lush decay. But no, it's a sizable feast of rotting fruits that have fallen from her various fruit trees and must have been heaped up by some gardener she's not yet aware of. She cocks her ears beyond the wasps towards the house itself up the hill, where she pictures fluted columns and ruined balustrades above abandoned palace rooms. On a ballroom stage, a calliope exhales sad intervals, seeping through the terrace doors and down the garden into her. She thinks she hears a soft chime emanating from even lower down the slope, where her property ends in a thicket of vegetation that is such an awkward scramble to access she knows she will never go there. She sits up, peers in that direction, and sees a stirring of leaves and a restless waving of dead flower heads, although there's no breeze, as if an unseen attention is stalking her. Tingling with dark pleasure at the sensation of being watched by something sinister she cannot explain, she rises from the grass and presses back up the slopes to her terrace. She looks down to where she just was, seeking those flower heads, but can make out little detail with the rays of sinking sun in her eyes. She enters the kitchen, pours herself a shot of brandy, and comes back out to the terrace. Now that the sun's disk has vanished over the horizon, an automatic illumination scheme flicks on into its evening mode. She downs the brandy in one gulp, then looks around, seeing an array of sumptuously atmospheric pools of light that have just welled up the length and width of her land, all for her sake alone, it seems. Many kinds of vegetation are lit from underneath or within, in yellow, orange, or red, while the ground is illuminated in numerous soft-edged circles of white from low-rise cylindrical or conical light fittings planted in the earth, of different heights and diameters, but all with downward-slanting louvred sides, like insulator cones from a power station roof or exotic metal pine cones. She returns to the kitchen, where she takes out a new glass and bottle from the cabinet. When she re-emerges, pausing at the open terrace doors, she is holding a different drink from before, a drink more in tune with those nighttime grid lights spread out ahead, and with the cigarette smouldering in her other hand, a tumbler of bourbon on the rocks, as befits an LA cityscape, above which the opening of the end should be heard striking up across the sky over those silhouetted palms on the ridges of the canyons. Bourbon on the rocks. Making her the first beast who has intuited the drink that her creator was drinking when he set about creating her. She draws on the cigarette, tilts her head back, and puffs smoke out into the lamplight. She leans on the balustrade and savors a long swig of drink. A faint trace of heat from the land beneath the terrace is still perceptible, rising up behind the growing cool of the evening air. She raises the tumbler to eye level, feeling the condensation on the glass against her forehead, and peers inside it through bourbon and ice. The lights of Los Angeles are distorted into squeaky lines and smudgy points, and the bones of the moon's disk flip and swing high to the west, where a crawling sea stretches to a whiskey horizon. Yes, the darkness in her appointed game, the Platinum Raven, whose harsh lights and shadows she can sense ahead of her, will be quite something to get used to, and to bear responsibility for. She has also caught glimpses of another game world called the Imagination Thief, from overhearing murmurs by Jaymi about three other beasts named Shigem and Kim and Evelyn, who would seem to have been allotted to that title. It sounds as if there will be quite as much darkness in that game as in her own one, though she is absolved from whatever will occur in the Imagination Thief, not being destined to play any part in it herself. But there will be no such absolution for her soon-to-be-created housemate, whose imminence she can also now sense, almost better than Jaymi can sense it, Scorpio, the sole beast who will be cast to play a part in both games, as she has intuited from half-murmurs by their mutual creator. She knows as much as I do, Jaymi thinks, down the hills. So Scorpio will have to get used to and bear responsibility for twice as much darkness as she or any other beast will. What will Scorpio be like, she wonders, aloud in pink noise. Take a look, Jaymi whispers back, up the nighttime canyons from Electra Drive. Okay, she will. So she presses the tumbler to her forehead once again, and seen through the bourbon, a landscape assumes a hint of bitumen. A line of pylons march across a black field of kerosene. Rivers of shadow wash the feet of rust-coloured stalagmites, across which is draped a pale brown organic form that's at once ethereal and carnal.